Don't do it for us. Do it for your grandkids.
Yeah, they're talking about the life-saving decision to get genetic testing. An Omaha family finds their bond through blood also puts them at risk. Chronicle's Julie Cornell takes you to the unique center in Omaha, giving them the knowledge to fight cancer before it begins.
There's something about the bond between a mother and her daughters. They've shared laughs, but also heartache.
I was diagnosed with breast cancer in October of 94.
Bernice Lubers went through chemo, stem cell replacement, radiation, and then 10 years later, she developed uterine cancer.
Between that 10 years of 94 and 04, I had two sisters that were both diagnosed with breast cancer and one with colon cancer.
But it wasn't until genetic testing she learned she carries the gene for colon cancer.
I was extremely shocked.
It was her daughter, Jenny, who led the charge in getting the family tested at the CHI Breast Health Center. It's on the Lakeside campus.
They had me fill out the high-risk assessment. We went through the pedigree and all that stuff. They drew blood that day and they ran the genetics test.
It's a simple test using either blood or saliva. Results come back within 2 weeks.
It's very accurate.
Nurse practitioner Kate Hunley runs the center's high-risk assessment program.
In some cases, if we have a known mutation within a family, it provides us the information to better stratify who's at risk and who's not.
In Bernice, they detected the PMS2 gene. It's known to cause uterine and colon cancer.
That was the missing piece in my roadmap up to that point.
Of her three daughters, Bernice only passed the mutation on to Jessie.
I mean, there's a 50% chance that she passed it on, and I'm the only one that got it.
But that knowledge is power. The genetic testing now paves a path for all four women to beat cancer before it begins.
Being my age, I wouldn't normally get colonoscopies, but now I get them yearly. Colon cancer is so treatable that if you find it early, it's taken care of.
Still, identifying the colon cancer gene didn't answer why Bernice, as well as two of her sisters, all had breast cancer.
Sure, this test is negative today, but this is a huge area of research. They're finding new information every day.
So just because no breast cancer gene's been found in these women doesn't mean it won't be discovered.
They're constantly adding new genes to these tests.
That's why the daughters with no mutation still have to take their high-risk assessment seriously. It makes them candidates for testing they never would have qualified for.
I just knew we qualified for mammograms 10 years prior to when my mom was diagnosed. But other than that, I didn't know we qualified for any other testing like these breast MRIs. I would have had no idea.
Daughters Jenny and Kate are living proof this new process works.
And I just had a breast MRI this January, 3 months ago, and it came back with a hot spot.
Both sisters have had abnormal breast MRIs.
It came back with a lump that was precancerous. I would have never had an MRI, right. I would have had mammograms, but they didn't find it in the mammogram. They found it in the MRI.
So take it from a survivor.
Tools are there. The knowledge is there. The people are there. There's no reason not to have these tests run.
Having that knowledge today could save lives, decades, even centuries down the road.
It's not about me. It's really not about my daughters at this point, but it's really about the generations to come.
That was Julie Cornell reporting. CHI's Breast Health Center is a triple accredited center of excellence, one of only 11 like it in the country. As for Jessie, the daughter who had the gene passed on to her, she's now made it her mission to inform her extended family of the risks. She had CHI create a letter explaining their situation, why it's so important they consider getting genetic testing. Turns out three of her cousins also have that colon cancer gene. So let's talk about that. Here with me from CHI are Dr. Michael McNamara, he's a surgeon, and also Dr. Katie Mendlich, a radiologist. So it's pretty interesting. We had a family there who had the colon cancer gene, but they found out they were also high risk for breast cancer. Why is that? What makes someone high risk?
As part of when people come in for their mammograms at CHI at Lakeside, we do an intake form assessing family history. Mm-hmm. And particularly if we notice that somebody has a strain of cancers, I happen to work in breast cancer, but there's a number of cancers that have a genetic component to them and a link, breast and colon. So if you've got a family history of multiple cancers on one side of the family, it's a red flag that genetic testing might need to follow.
Are there certain groups that are higher risk?
When we're talking about breast cancer, two of the largest known mutations are the BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutation, but there's multiple additional genetic tests and different syndromes that do link other cancers with breast cancer that could red flag us that somebody needs additional testing.
So it used to just be the two tests, the BRCA1 and 2. Mm-hmm. Now it's an extended panel, which is studies, 28 or more potential gene mutations, and that's why it can pick up if you're susceptible or at risk for colon cancer and some others. So it's when we identify a woman's at high risk for breast cancer and recommend the testing, we typically always are going to say, you should do the extended panel testing because it's going to be more extensive.
Are there risk factors or is it just straight up genetics?
So no, there are risk factors. So genetics play a factor, family history, but then, like a person's own personal history, if they've had breast cancer, they're at high risk of getting another one. So they're followed closely. But then it's really all about estrogen levels, because estrogen and progesterone will stimulate breast cells to create and stimulate an abnormal cell population that can create a cancer. So conditions that increase estrogen, long-term use of birth control pills, if you've used estrogen replacement after menopause, if you had early onset of your menstrual cycles early in your teens, or if you never had any pregnancies, or if you have late menopause, these are all things that extend your estrogen exposure and can increase your risk.
Can lifestyle choices, alcohol, weight, inactivity?
So yes is the answer. So because obesity is a risk factor, so is moderate to maybe greater than moderate alcohol consumption. And one of the reasons for obesity is because estrogen can also be stored in fat cells. So they'll have potentially higher circulating levels of estrogens.
Let's talk detection a little bit. Dr. Menlich, we heard in the piece, one of the women said she got an MRI, but she wouldn't have got the mammogram. Mm-hmm. I know there's a difference, but is there one better than the other?
So we recommend mammogram for all women, beginning at age 40, no matter what your risk, and earlier if your family history warrants. Breast MRI is a great additional supplemental screening tool in addition to mammograms. It's best for the high risk population, those that have a calculated lifetime risk of greater than 20 to 25%, which we can obtain through a variety of different surveys or genetic testing. Those that are high risk, in addition to their annual mammogram, we recommend their annual MRI.
I know it's a smaller subset of the society, but men. Is the same recommendation for men to get checked, and how do they get checked?
So men can come up because of their family history, and men can carry the BRCA gene. So we don't generally screen men for breast cancer, but those that are known BRCA positive should have a clinical exam beginning at age 35 by their doctor. And if they want to consider additional imaging, they could. It's something that would depend on their clinical exam with their doctor.
There's a late Dr. Henry Lynch. I mean, he's a legend in Omaha. I had the opportunity to interview him earlier this year, he died earlier this year, unfortunately. He actually came up with the Lynch syndrome, as you guys know, dealing with the BRCA gene tied to hereditary breast cancer. He told me he found it when he was talking to a guy in 1961, and the guy just happened to mention offhand that he had a bunch of family that had a family history of cancer. And then that led Lynch then to the testing. How crucial is genetic testing then to the whole picture of detection?
Well, the vast majority of breast cancers are still going to be non-genetically linked. And so they're just sporadic based on the risk factors that we talked about before. So, but in that population that's recognized, we're getting much more aggressive with the recommendation for the testing. Mm-hmm. And in addition to the genetic testing, in terms of treatment, we're also doing some specific genetic tests of the tumors after they're removed that will also help determine how aggressive we have to be with therapy, whether or not that patient's a candidate for chemotherapy. So genetics is leading us down a road not only to detection, but better treatment.
Nice. And we were also on the detection. There's signs and symptoms for a woman that she can tell that, hey, maybe something's not right here. What are those?
I would say that, number one, most breast cancers which are detected mammographically, mm-hmm. which is a good thing because we can detect them at an earlier stage. Mm-hmm. It's really, but we encourage all women to do self-breast exams. Mm-hmm. A lot of women might notice, they don't necessarily notice a mass per se. Now, some do, but some just notice some pressure feeling in the breast. The nipple area may look different. Right. It may start to even indent itself a little bit, which is a sign of something underneath that could be developing. So self-breast exams are still a cornerstone that we really emphasize to everybody.
Mm-hmm. And then, okay, when they come into you, I mean, what do you tell them? I mean, do you try to reassure them right away that maybe, hey, I found something, I didn't know if it was, it seems a little funny. What do you tell somebody? What should they expect, basically, when they come see you?
Well, anytime a patient notices something new, they should come in and see us. We don't want them to ignore anything. Right. So generally, if a patient feels something, we do get the opportunity to typically do an ultrasound and talk to them. And most women want to know if it is something that's benign, such as a cyst. They are thrilled. But if it is something that needs any further treatment, they want to know and be able to act upon it, and if they need a biopsy, know as early as possible.
And there's some people who, I mean, the discussion of whether you want to know what the result is, some people would look at the, what time do you get a preventative mastectomy? I mean, that's kind of the severe, some people say, I want it done. I want that off my body, out, and I don't have to deal with it again. When, is there a point when they hit that?
It's a personal choice, mm-hmm. but studies have shown that in terms of long-term survival and the average risk population, that bilateral mastectomy doesn't add anything necessarily over lumpectomy unless they are genetically predisposed to cancers.
And that's one of the things that I always talk about when I first counsel patients about their surgical choices, because the good news is the vast majority of these cancers are being caught early, mm-hmm. so they're either stage one or stage two, and with that, really breast cancer is a curable disease. And so then you just have to talk to them about, you know, because we've had hundreds of studies looking at, you know, what we call breast conservation therapy, where we just do a partial mastectomy or a lumpectomy, followed by radiation to the breast, compared to mastectomy. And really the survival rates are completely equal for every single stage. And so there's even some studies that are indicating that breast conservation therapy may offer some survival advantages over time, and because there's some extra benefit with the radiation.
So. Dr. McNamara, thanks very much. Dr. Macklin, also, you. Thank you very much. And get treated early. Get tested early, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Get your mammogram.
Absolutely.
Get your mammogram. Well, we've been talking about the latest advancements and treatments for breast cancer. Up next, the tiny seed that's pinpointing small tumors, giving doctors more flexibility and patients more comfort. Welcome back to Chronicle. This morning we're talking about developments in breast cancer treatment and prevention. Local surgeons say this tiny seed helps them pinpoint and remove small breast cancer tumors. It's teamwork that helps doctors and patients. Chronicle's Chin Doan has a story.
Spiculated mass. This is highly suspicious for an invasive breast cancer.
A routine 3D mammogram in February turned out to be life-changing for Shelly Whitman. She had cancer in her left breast.
I was like, well, I go, you know, it does happen, and I just deal with it.
The 68-year-old was optimistic since the tumor was about 18 millimeters and in stage one. For the lumpectomy, her doctors at Methodist Estabrook Cancer Center chose a relatively new procedure. This is the I-125 seed, the size of a pencil lead, helping surgeons pinpoint and remove a tumor.
You know, we'll clean off the breast, we'll numb up the skin, and then slide that needle in, and then place the seed. That takes 30 seconds to a minute. It's fast. That's the seed that's in the breast cancer.
Imaging director Richard Kudelek says it's teamwork between radiology, surgery, and nuclear medicine. A radiologist inserts the seed, which contains trace amounts of radioactive material that's less than a drop of iodine. Then the surgeon finds the tumor with a special detector.
We don't have to even protect pregnant personnel from it, so it's a very small amount of radioactivity.
Dr. James Riley led the effort to bringing this procedure to Methodist. He says the seed allows surgeons to choose when and where to do the incision. Riley adds it's more convenient, comfortable, and cosmetically appealing than the more common method of inserting a wire through the skin.
rather than having to follow where the wire was put in before. So it might let you do a more cosmetic incision or place it in some place where it would be a little bit better hidden.
Back to Whitman, she went home a few hours after the tumor was removed.
It went pretty much as I expected, and I only needed one pain pill that night.
And good news so far, she's in the clear.
And all my reports have come back very good. There was no cancer in the margins. There was no, they only took one lymph node. There was no cancer in that.
In Omaha, Chin Doan, KETV Newswatch 7.
Methodists used the seed in 35 patients. Right now, doctors are only using the method on smaller tumors in breasts, but they say it does have potential for other surgeries. And we have just a few days left, but before the rest of October, you can get a low-cost mammogram for $149 if you use the MD Save program through CHI Health. Basically a health care coupon, and if you pay the $149 up front instead of using insurance. Find more information now on our website. Just type MD Save in the search bar. Remember, if you missed any part of this show or you want to see it again, put it on our website, ketv.com. Go to our homepage, click on the menu button, and look for Chronicle. I'm Rob McCartney. Thanks for watching. We'll see you back here next Sunday morning for KETV News Watch 7's Chronicle.